Chapter 4 How the Leopard Got His Spots. In the days when everybody started fair, best beloved, the leopard lived in a place called the High Veldt. Remember, it wasn't the Low Veldt or the Bush Veldt or the Sour Veldt, but the exclusively bare, hot, shiny High Veldt, where there was sand and sandy-colored rock and exclusively tufts of sandy yellowish grass. The giraffe and the zebra and the eland and the kudu and the hart beast lived there, and they were exclusively sandy yellow brownish all over, but the leopard, he was the exclusivest, sandiest, yellowish, brownest of them all, a grayish-yellowish, catty-shaped kind of beast, and he matched the exclusively yellowish, grayish, brownish color of the High Veldt to one hair. This was very bad for the giraffe and the zebra and the rest of them, for he would lie down by a exclusively yellowish, grayish, brownish stone or clump of grass, and when the giraffe or the zebra or the eland or the kudu or the bushbuck or the bontebuck came by, he would surprise them out of their jumpsome lives. He would indeed. And also there was an Ethiopian with bows and arrows, a exclusively grayish, brownish, yellowish man he was then, who lived on the High Veldt with the leopard, and the two used to hunt together. The Ethiopian with his bows and arrows, and the leopard exclusively with his teeth and claws, till the giraffe and the eland and the kudu and the quagga and all the rest of them didn't know which way to jump, best beloved. They didn't indeed. After a long time, things lived forever so long in those days, they learned to avoid anything that looked like a leopard or an Ethiopian. And bit by bit, the giraffe began it because his legs were the longest, they went away from the High Veldt. They scuttled for days and days and days till they came to a great forest exclusively full of trees and bushes and stripy, speckled, patchy, blotchy shadows, and there they hid. And after another long time, what with standing half in the shade and half out of it, and what with the slippery, slidey shadows of the trees falling on them, the giraffe grew blotchy, and the zebra grew stripy, and the eland and the kudu grew darker, with little wavy gray lines on their backs, like bark on a tree trunk. And so, though you could hear them and smell them, you could very seldom see them, and then only when you knew precisely where to look. They had a beautiful time in the exclusively speckly, spickly shadows of the forest, while the leopard and the Ethiopian ran about over the exclusively grayish, yellowish, reddish High Veldt outside, wondering where all their breakfasts and their dinners and their teas had gone. At last they were so hungry that they ate rats and beetles and rock rabbits, the leopard and the Ethiopian, and then they had the big tummy ache, both together, and then they met Bavian, the dog-headed, barking baboon, who is quite the wisest animal in all South Africa.